If you could all take seats, please, we'll get started. As you're taking your seats, let me say a good evening to all of you and welcome. Welcome on behalf of the McDonald Center for the Space Sciences and the Department of Earth and Planetary Sciences to the inaugural Distinguished Earth and Planetary Sciences Lecture by Professor Ray Arvidson, something about 50 years of exploring Mars. Now, my main job is to introduce the individual who will introduce Ray. But before I do that, I wanted to make a few announcements. First of all, we do have folks on YouTube. And if you have a question on YouTube, please feel free to put it into the chat. Welcome to all of you as well. But I really want to say, again, welcome to the university community. I see a number of faces from our administration here. We're pleased to have you. To the St. Louis community, a number of you I've seen at many meetings, and I know this is a great town for space science and interest in things like exploring Mars. And indeed, welcome to visitors and guests from around the country, even a few from Europe who have made the trek, many of whom are former students of Ray Arvidson. So with that in mind, I'd like to ask, if you are a former student of Ray Arvidson and you're on YouTube, please put a note in the chat, say hello so we know you're there. And if you are a former student of Ray Arvidson and you're here in the auditorium, would you please stand and be recognized? To me, there's no greater honor and legacy than to have so many fine former students, and many of whom have gone on to do great things, and at least one of which I think Ray has had to work for now in the past. So let me now introduce Provost Emeritus Ed Macias, who is the Barbara and David Thomas Distinguished Professor in Arts and Sciences for Washington University in St. Louis. He joined the Arts and Sciences faculty in 1970 in the Department of Chemistry. So he's known Ray for even longer than I have, and since the time that Ray first came to the university. Ed eventually served as chair of the chemistry department, and he also served as director of the summer school program. He was appointed provost in 1988, and in 1995 was named dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences and executive vice chancellor for academic affairs. He's been called upon to assist national and governmental institutions, including the National Research Council of the National Academy of Sciences, where he chaired the Committee on Nuclear and Radiochemistry. He has truly had a distinguished career at Washington University, and it's my great pleasure to introduce Provost Emeritus Ed Macias, who will introduce Professor Arvidson.
Well, good evening. It's a real honor for me to be here to introduce Ray. We've known each other for a long time. But we're here today as colleagues, as friends, former and current students, admirers of Ray Arvidson, who is the James S. McDonald Distinguished University Professor, now emeritus at Washington U. And Ray has done great things in his 48-year career at Washington U that you may have read about in the program or you know personally. Let me just mention a very few highlights. He's participated and has had leadership roles in many planetary missions focused on Mars and Venus. He chaired the Earth Science Department for nearly two decades. He helped initiate the Environmental Studies Program. He initiated and led the Hewlett and Pathfinder programs in environmental sustainability, which has 330 alumni who are now physicians, lawyers, scientists, and professors at universities. Ray has done beautiful work while he's been here. He's really one of a kind. For his work, Ray has won many awards, such as he's a fellow of the Geological Society of America, a fellow of the American Geophysical Union, the AGU. He's won the AGU Whipple Award. He has been named the Missouri Governor's Award for Excellence in Teaching. He's received 3 NASA Public Service Medals and several dozen citations for excellence for his mission-related and research work on planetary orbital and landed missions. From Washington University, he's received the Arthur Holly Compton Award and the Wiedenbaum Medal. And Ray just told me a few minutes ago, he's written over 400 papers, but perhaps even more importantly, he's now the 16th most cited researcher in Earth and planetary sciences. That's really an amazing accomplishment. I first met Ray when we were both new professors at Washington University. I believe our first meeting was at a new faculty dinner where both Ray's wife Eloise and my wife Teddy attended. And we've been good friends ever since. Shortly after Ray came, Larry Haskin was chair of Earth and Planetary Sciences. Larry was a great model for departmental and university leadership. Ray followed Larry as chair and became every bit as effective and more. I mentioned that Ray initiated the Pathfinder program. Let me just say a word about that. In the early 1990s, Jim McLeod, then dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, received a grant from the Hewlett-Packard Foundation to build some new and really revolutionary programs for first-year students and beyond. We brought together some very creative people in arts and sciences to think about a few special programs. Ray was one of that group. That grant led ultimately to 3 outstanding programs: Mind and Brain, American Culture Studies, and Pathfinder, then called, all were called Hewlett programs. These programs became so popular that students would come to Washington U specially to participate in one of them. The Pathfinder students were always among the most talented students in the first year class. John Berg, who was then head of undergraduate missions, used to say that Ray and the Pathfinder program made his job a real success. Really, I think it's fair to say that the Pathfinder program is unique, and under Ray's leadership, it became one of our crown jewels. We have seen how many Pathfinder students there are from, you saw a bunch of people standing, many of them were Pathfinder students. As long as I've known Ray, I've been so impressed with how much he cares about people, particularly his students. He follows them forever, or so it seems. I'm sure you will hear more about these students from Ray in a moment. I want to make special note of Ray's wife, Eloise. She has made so much of what Ray does possible. She too was very close to the Pathfinder program and its students. She's fabulous in every way. Eloise, would you stand, please? Please stand. Most of all, I consider Ray a good friend, and I will always treasure our friendship. We have been through a lot together, and working with Ray has been a real highlight of my career at Washington University. And now, Ray Arvidson.
Well, folks, we're ready to go to Mars. Yeah, we're gonna start back in 1976 and take us up through today. Some folks I do want to introduce. You've seen Eloise. This is my son, Tim, who was a surprise visit from Phoenix today, walking into the lab. And my younger son, Lars, who works for the university. And his wife, Shelley. And our 2 granddaughters, what's your name? Lexi and Lainey. There's one other group I need to introduce. The second row here, very, very famous group. I call them my posse. They come to all my talks, they sit in the front. They're a little aged, so they have to take out their phones and punch in their questions in order to remember toward the end of the hour. Tonight, they're my security detail. So if anyone gets a little bit rowdy, you guys, if you can stand up and get to them, you want to do that. So you're all hired. for $0, so, and recruited and trained, so we're ready to go. We arrived on campus on January 1st, 1974. As my good friend Ed said, you know, we've been doing all sorts of things since then, a lot of teaching, a lot of research. I've been so lucky to arrive here just as the kind of growth of the university in excellence and content has been going on. When I arrived, there were basically four faculty members in earth sciences, and now we're an international powerhouse with work in planetary sciences, environmental sciences, geophysics, geochemistry. It's really fun to see the growth of that department through the various chairs. Tomorrow at 1:30, there's an open house. So if you go to Rudolph Hall in the main area of the atrium where the Opportunity and Spirit Rover models located, you'll be able to see some tours. And I'm doing a pretty boring talk in here tomorrow at 4. We're going to talk about the geology of Mars and the sedimentology, but I still want you to come. But it's not going to be as much fun as it is going to be tonight. So just a forewarning, but I expect to see everybody here. Posse? Okay, your security. We've been through a lot together, right, the posse. Where's Hoyerman? Well, you belong there. You're part of the posse. Well, who should we eject? Okay. Your security tomorrow. Okay, good. So let's see. I did retire at the end of June. Some of you in this audience are retired. I should have talked to you beforehand. I had no idea how to handle Social Security, Medicare, A and B, United Healthcare, and it doesn't cover your teeth. It doesn't cover your eyes. I'm not sure it covers your feet, in addition to life insurance and all the rest. But Eloise and I have struggled through it, so I think we're all set. Although, gosh, it was pretty rocky. But let's take a look at what we're doing here. So what do I study? I study Earth. It is our primary planet that we need to take care of. It is my most loved planet, and I've done a lot of field work on the Earth. I also love Mars and Venus. On Mars, because it's accessible, and there have been a number of orbital and landed missions that I've participated in. Magellan, because it's really interesting. It's like Earth gone wild with a runaway greenhouse effect. So as I take you through my history, I'm going to give you background information you're not going to find on Google. You'll find the final result, but not, in fact, you know, how we got there. So are we ready? All right. Venus is too hot for my sense. Earth is just right. Mars is too cold, but used to be warm and wet. And that's the main message of tonight at the end of this talk. But here's my career in terms of research. Encapsulated from 1970 to 2022. I was actually involved in the Viking landers 1 and 2. Many of you weren't even alive back then, but the U.S. put two landers on the surface of Mars in 1976, in part to celebrate the bicentennial. So I'll talk about that mission. That was not very successful in terms of trying to find evidence for life. Digging into the Martian regolith we call planetary soil, putting it into the spacecraft, no organics to speak of, no evidence for life. And that led to this what's called gap, where there wasn't much interest by NASA in terms of going back to Mars. And during that time, I did work in Egypt, the eastern and western deserts of Egypt. Some of my students are here, Hawaii, with a lot of trips with Pathfinders and ULIT folks, Mojave Desert in California, even the Missouri River in 1993 during the big floods. And there's another mission called Magellan, which is a radar mapper around Venus that I was on the science team for, and it's produced the images of the surface. It's a crazy planet, right? 90 room times pressure in this room of atmosphere, carbon dioxide. It's a runaway greenhouse effect. It has sulfuric acid clouds. It rains sulfuric acid. So we used the radar mapper to penetrate beneath, and that was really interesting. But then there was the realization that you don't want to look at modern Mars and the modern soil because of all the radiation coming down. But you want to go back to the ancient rock record. And that led to all these missions from where it says Magellan to Perseverance rover today. Orbital missions that I was involved in, the Mars Express, which is a European Mars reconnaissance orbiter, producing exquisite images that I'll show you. Prototype rover field trials. It began to be realized by NASA that we need to get on the surface. Geologists call it boots on the ground, where you're actually touching the rocks and doing measurements on the rocks, both kind of in situ and taking pieces back into the spacecraft and eventually returning samples to the Earth. Turns out to be a fascinating planet that was warm and wet early in geologic time, as I'll show you. So we did a lot of rover field tests, and I'll show you some of those. And then Spirit and Opportunity, there were two rovers that touched down in 2004. And I was the deputy principal investigator for that mission, or pair of missions. Gosh, Opportunity lasted way out of warranty. It was supposed to be like 3 months. It lasted from January 2004 to June 2018. Way out of warranty, just a well-made American vehicle. And we didn't lose it because of failure of the system. There was so much dust coming down on the solar panels. The last time she talked to us, she said, "I just looked at the sun and couldn't find it. I think I have 1/40th the amount of solar energy needed to survive because of a massive dust storm around Mars, the red planet." And we never heard from her again. Well, after 2 weeks of not hearing from her and getting information to her, we knew it would lose its sense of time. But we still tried to hail it through the big radio telescopes that NASA has through January. Steve Squires, professor at Cornell, now chief scientist for Blue Origin, was the principal investigator. I was the deputy principal investigator. And we were told by the NASA administrator, you know, Steve and Ray, this is it. You know, we've gone many, many months. We've never heard from the vehicle. That's the end of the mission. So it was phenomenal. Way, way much more science than we thought. And then the Phoenix lander, I'll talk about that, in 2008. Curiosity rover landed in 2012, still operating, and Perseverance landed in February 2021 and still operating. Now, back in the Viking lander period, there was no sense of what to do with the data after the data were collected. So I remember being involved in the mission at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, and toward the end of the mission, we needed to archive our data at the National Space Science Data Center in Greenbelt, Maryland. So have you guys seen Raiders of the Lost Ark? Remember what happened at the end with the big warehouse? That's exactly it. I remember stuffing microfiche and microfilm and paper tape, and remember IBM 360 printouts, boxes of those. And as a gentleman that came in and showed me actually prints from the Viking lander that he's carrying around still, and we explained, you know, how those were produced. A big I with no O. A big input, but there's no way to get output. So that led to a National Academy of Study that I participated in saying, hey, we need to do better. Our descendants should be looking at the data and the reasons the data were acquired. And gee, here's a thought. Put the archives where there are people who use them, scientists. So we are the home to the NASA Planetary Data System Geosciences Node. And we archive about 3 terabytes of data and work with all the missions from Mercury, Venus, Earth's moon, and Mars. And our data are documented and people are accessing the data at seemingly alarming increasing rates with time. So that's just completely turned around. And there are a dozen employees, many of them staff members who are sitting in this room who helped make that happen. But let's start with Viking Landers 1 and 2. Mars, why? Because today it's not so hospitable. You go back 3.5 billion years ago, and it was a different object. It was warm and wet. There were rivers, there were lakes, there were steam-charged volcanoes. And that's when we think, if at all, Mars was habitable, and maybe life even got started and evolved. But the evidence is in the rock record. So it's the boots on the ground that we have to get at. But let's start with Viking Lander 1. First successful landed mission on Mars, summer of 1976, with a scoop to dig into the regolith, the soil, put it into the lander, and search for organics and life. No results. It kind of put us into the doldrums in terms of exploring Mars. On the other hand, it's kind of an Earth-like landscape. It was eerily like the Earth, and I'll show you some of the pictures from that first mission. Ah, you know this guy, right? So there's Carl, unfortunately, great scientist, great spokesman, but he's passed away. That's the Viking lander test vehicle in the Mojave Desert. And of course it landed, it was attached to, the two landers were attached to Viking Orbiter 1 and Viking Orbiter 2, and in July and September were commanded respectively to detach and to land with an aero shield, parachutes, and then retro rockets. Our job on the science team was on the camera. This is folks built in the late 1960s, early 1970s. Did we have PCs and Macs? No, students, we didn't. Did we have calculators, hand calculators? No, we had those big old things where you punch numbers, and if you're lucky, something comes out. Did we have terminals? For the most part, no. You punch cards, you put them in, and then a big printout comes out, some of which is still at the National Space Science Data Center. It was a different process. So we did land in July 1976. I was part of the science team. And the first 90 days of the mission, you live on what's called Mars time. And Mars has a day almost the same as the Earth's in terms of the rotation rate, but it's 39 minutes longer. So on your shift, you go in to work 39 minutes later each day. And after a week or so, you have no idea, you know, where, which planet you're on, because you have this odd jet lag. So I shared an office with Carl Sagan for 3 days. Remember Johnny Carson and the Tonight Show? For some of you in the audience, he was the early Tonight Show guy, one of the earliest. So Carl was famous, but disfamous. And I was no famous. I was 28, he was however old. He was already a famous scientist. He did some of the greenhouse warming on Venus and whatnot. So we're in there and we're doing our science. He talked to me and we've actually written papers together. The fourth day, the secretary was emptying out his part of the office. He said, what happened? His office is next to the director's office of JPL. Why? He was on the Johnny Carson show. He was on the Johnny Carson show. Johnny Carson show back then, between the sections where their advertisements called a slug. And he was supposed to be on there one slug. He was on three slug. And he knocked off famous people. And that led to Carl's important and necessary and well-deserved ascent into the ether. So that's our story of working with Carl. And we did finish up the papers that we had started. He's a brilliant guy. Eloise, you met him. He was very much a gentleman. A little egotistical, but aren't we all? Now, we landed, and this is the first image that came back. This was something called a facsimile camera. This is 19, built in the 60s and early 70s. So it takes one line, and the whole camera rotates another line, another line, another line. So it builds up from right to left. And you can see that kind of goes goofy toward the end because we were losing the communication. Now, back then, there was a JPL media room and then the team room. And there was only one link between the science team room and the media room. I was on the headphones with the team leader for the lander imaging system called Tim Much, who was my professor at Brown University for my PhD. And I was supposed to look at the image at the same time, because Tim was pretty excited, and he was in the media room going out to, you know, the universe, the known universe. So I was supposed to gather information from the science team, formulate it into some pithy comments, and send them to Tim so he could repeat them. And I looked behind me, they were all jumping up and down, including Carl Sagan. And there was nothing useful coming out of their mouths because we didn't actually expect this to work. And we saw the footpad with some soil in it, we saw rocks, and then lost the communication. So I said, okay, I'm gonna do this. Okay, Tim, here's what you say. We landed successfully. The footpad is in good shape. The regolith is inside, or the soil. And we have rocks, and they're etched by wind, and we have fine-grained material in between. Yeah, okay. And when he went on, oh my God, we landed successfully. And that was about all we could get out. Then we took our first panorama about a week later in black and white, subsequently in color. And you can see the American flag and you can see the deck, that little white thing kind of poking out there. That is the meteorology boom. This is the antenna to communicate back to the Earth. And we saw a big boulder about this big, probably a piece of ejecta from a crater, fairly recent. And the original name was Big Bertha. This was 1976. There was still a feminist movement back then. And Big Bertha, I think, was a big old cannon that was used in World War I. So we decided right then, let's change this. And that's how it became known as Big Joe. So you'll never find anything, I don't think, on Google or otherwise that talks about the original name, but it's known as Big Joe. And it's really interesting. This is the color. Now, the other thing that happened is we have color charts on the lander, and we could take pictures in color, but until we got pictures of those color charts, we couldn't balance it. So the first images out were produced with a blue sky, which Mars doesn't have. There's so much dust in this thin atmosphere that it's always kind of a salmon pink. So this isn't properly processed, but we went from blue sky to kind of salmon pink sky, you know, once we got the calibration. So we had to retract all that information. But you can see it's eerily like the Earth. And the subsequent images I'm going to show you make even that case more strongly. This is a planet that was like the Earth in terms of warm, wet conditions 3.5 to 4 billion years ago. Since then, wind has been acting as the primary erosional depositional ebb, but it leaves all the morphology behind. And you can see those big boulders in the horizon are just almost completely covered by what turned out to be sand. Negative results. I mean, it was beautiful in terms of the geology and the geophysics and the atmospheric sciences, a total bummer out in terms of no organics, no evidence for life that anyone believed, except for one person. So that led to this gap, but then became the realization that you need to look at the ancient rock record, which is really well exposed because of wind erosion. And boots on the ground was what we needed. And we developed, and I help lead this, this whole idea that first you follow the water, that is find the rocks that formed in a water environment or were altered in a water environment. Once you get those, take a look at whether or not you can find evidence in the key rocks, those rocks that formed in water, was the environment habitable? Not whether or not life got started and evolved, but were the conditions right? And then finally, search for evidence in the ones that are most habitable for past or even extant life. And that's kind of what we're doing. And we're kind of in the habitable part right now. And that's what Curiosity is doing. That's what Spirit and Opportunity did. That's what the Phoenix Lander, which is what I'm going to talk about after we discuss this important topic. Well, we'll talk about Phoenix now. That's 2008. It landed just above the Arctic Circle because from orbit, with an Odyssey orbiter, in fact, the project scientist Jeff Plout is in the audience, a former graduate student. Phoenix touched down above the Arctic Circle where one of the instruments on the Odyssey orbiter, a NASA orbiter, was looking at neutrons and the neutron detector and found evidence for hydrogen, which was present probably in the form of ice, just a few inches beneath the surface. And boots on the ground with Phoenix to test that idea and see what they could get. So here it is. It came down just like Viking, except it was a direct entry from Earth. So aeroshield, parachute, retro rockets, and a touchdown, and it just worked totally perfectly. Now, here's a problem that we had. Up at the high latitudes, there are many rocks, and the rocks are up to this big, and that's about the distance from the footpad to the underbelly. You land on the rock and you're gone. There's not a mission. So who was in charge, the co-lead for finding a safe landing site? Yours truly, with a JPL engineer. So that was a big problem until it turned out we found a location to do it. Now we kind of, just before we landed, this is 2007, unfortunately, we lost one of our great explorers and alumnus of the university, Steve Fawcett, killed in an airplane accident. And when his wife declared him legally dead, the courts declared him legally dead, she had a big to-do in the Adler Planetarium. So Eloise and I went up with Bill Danforth and others to celebrate Steve's life. Eloise, of course, went off on her own and met, I don't know, who were those people you met? Carol from Hawaii. Oh, I'm telling that story. You tell me who you talked to. Richard Branson. Baron von Hilton, and she asked. Baron von Hilton. Sir Edmund Hillary's kid. Thanks a lot, Eloise. Okay, she does go off in the bathroom, and she meets a lady called Carol, not Sue. Carol from Ohio. And I'm seated there, it's dinner time, I'm seated there talking to Bill Danforth, which doesn't happen all that often. He's a fantastic individual, I'm sorry he's passed. And Eloise comes up to me and says, you need to come with me. I said, no, Eloise, I'm talking to Bill Danforth, just go do your thing. You need to come with me. So I was walking up, and Carol said to Eloise before then, my husband's off in the corner having dinner. Come sit with us, but we like to be off in the corner. So I'm about this distance to my family. It's freaking Neil Armstrong. So like a total doofus, my jaw drops down, and I stand there just staring at him. And I said to my brain wasn't working, right? Because it's Neil Armstrong, right? So finally, I got my composure back and introduced myself. He looked exactly like he'd go to the moon. Total right stuff. Total gentleman. And Carol was nice, too. Sat down, and we started talking. And he said, before I said my name and my institution, he said, hey, Ray, I understand you're having problems trying to find a place for the Phoenix to land a touchdown because of the rocks. And I went into a stupor again. And then tried to compose. And you have to realize, for the younger folks in the audience, he had to take her over the limb in order to find a proper place to land. It was like 8 seconds of fuel because they were headed for a rocky area. Well, it turns out, ironically, the best place to land, this is long after, and then we stayed overnight in a hotel. Eloise claims, but I'm not sure it's true, that around 2 in the morning, I went straight up and I said, I met Neil Armstrong, and went back down. I can't vouch for this story, but I think it's probably true. Okay, so we feed forward and we find a good place to land. It turns out, ironically, to be on the ejecta deposit of this 6-mile diameter crater that had no name. And it turned out the ejecta coming out from this impact crater just wiped out the rocks, and we landed successfully. Now, the principal investigator of Phoenix was a gentleman named Peter Smith, professor at the University of Arizona in Tucson. Ironically, it's the Phoenix mission, but it was done in Tucson. But that's all another story. So Peter said, Ray, you're deeply involved in this. I know you co-led the landing site selection. You're going to do a lot of the operations. You're the robotic arm co-I. You're going to be involved in naming things. And I want you to name things only after fairy tales, because people resonate with fairy tales. You know, okay, Peter, whatever. So here's this unnamed crater. My father came from Sweden, and I know I love Norse mythology. I'll just name this crater after a Norse god. But if you've studied their mythology, they were really bad gods. So this guy was one of the least worse, and his idea was to guard this bridge between us and Asgard. And Asgard is where the gods lived, and Valhalla is where Odin lived. So it turns out, yeah, we actually did that. And I'm going to pronounce these names in Old Norse. If there are any Icelanders or Greenlanders in here, or from the Faroe Islands where they still speak Old Norse, I'm going to be watching you. So there's no smiling or grimacing, because I'm going to do my very best. So what you think might be Heimdall is actually Heimdall. And what you think might be Asgard is ice. And what else do we have? The bridge is Bifrost, more or less. Now, I said, yeah, okay, Peter, I'm going to do this. It went out as a press release. Next day, the International Astronomical Union Naming Committee on Features on Planets chairman called me. Said, Professor Arvidsson, you cannot unilaterally name things on planets. It is the job of the IAU naming committee. Oh, farts. Craters that size on Mars have to be named after towns with less than 10,000 people. Luckily, there's a hoops in Norway of the right size. So I got away with it, with a warning. You know, never try to do that again. So you won't find the backstory, but if you Google Heimdall Crater Mars, you won't find how it actually became named that and how I actually got away with it. I think I'm still on the bad list for that committee. Oh, by the way, the exquisite camera on Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, this little area down here, is the parachute and the descending lander before the pieces were removed. And it's shown here, but we didn't land in the crater, we moved over here. This is chock full of water ice. Okay, Now we're on the surface. It looks like this. This is an artist's concept. So we had a meteorology boom and measurements from Canada and Denmark. We had a camera that was basically a spare from the Pathfinder lander. We had a robotic arm that we thought we could buy as a spare, but we couldn't find it. That lander is used. We bought it from Lockheed Martin. It was all done on the cheap. And I was the robotic arm co-I and trying to get that icy soil, if we found it, and put it inside the lander to confirm that it's water ice or whatever it was going to be. So here we are, and we did start naming things after fairy tales for the most part. So there's Jack's house and there's Jack. And then here are ice polygons. We landed on planes. These ice polygons are the same that form in Antarctica. And it's kind of expansion and contraction, and kind of moves the rocks up in this cycle through the cracks. Solar powered. Now, here's the problem. We deployed the robotic arm, and the robotic arm had a camera on it. And as soon as we deploy the robotic arm, we wanted to look underneath the lander and see what was there, because we're coming down with these retro rockets kind of just throwing out hydrazine. And you got to realize, this is like a week or two into the mission, and you do this Mars time 39 minutes later each day, and you go kind of goofy. And I was one of the first to walk into the control area, which ironically was at University of Arizona in Tucson for the Phoenix mission, but that's another story. And I walked in, and the retro rockets had blown away the regolith, the soil, and exposed this big white thing. So I'm walking in, and I see the monitor, because we had monitors. And I said, holy, not cow. It was a word that was one syllable, ends with an S, ends with a T. And I thought to myself, oh, that's bad, Ray. So it became known as holy cow. So you can Google holy cow Mars, and you'll never know the original name, because it's been expunged from the literature. It is water ice, and it disappeared in 2 weeks. Because once you take away that few inches of regolith, it's no longer in equilibrium with the atmosphere. And it goes directly from ice solid to vapor. It's what's called sublimation. Did we dig around? Yep. Here's a view of the robotic arm seen from the camera on the mast. And it had a scoop. It had something called a rasp. Because this icy soil that we presumed was there is so cold and so hard that you could scrape it, but it hardly gets scraped because it's like a rock. So we actually purchased a rasp, which is what a chef does to make a carving from ice. And that's kind of poking out there. So what we would do is put that scoop down and drill a whole bunch of holes and then take the scoop and scoop it up. And then, there's a story that goes with that. But there's also a little instrument there called a TECP, which was built and run by Aaron Zent, who was a WashU undergraduate and is now a staff member, PhD from the University of Hawaii, and he works at the NASA Ames Research Center. Anyway, we finally got some trenches, and we did name things after, well, mainly after fairy tales. Dodo, remember, that was the bird that went extinct and was there in Goldilocks. That's because the two trenches came together. So you can see the white areas, that's actually water ice. And you see these little pieces over here, little pieces over here. And those are chunks of ice that disappeared after about a week or so. Because that ice is right beneath the surface. But as soon as you remove that nice cover of the soil, the regolith, it just disappears. You could put those in sodas, right? It's just basically water ice. We weren't able to get these into our instruments on board the lander because they had to be in kind of ground up. So we actually got this icy soil in the scoop. Ah, success, because we have a lot of people calling us from NASA headquarters. Did you find the ice? Did you find the ice? Yeah, we found the ice. I found the ice. It's right under there. It's right there. Did you get the ice into the instruments on the lander? Got that in there. It's icy soil. You can see the bits of ice. You know, we took a picture of it, took it over, went over to the instrument. It wouldn't come out. It wouldn't come out. Well, that's embarrassing as the robotic arm co-investigator, right? So it turns out that when we do this dance from getting the icy soil to over the lander, the sunlight hit it. And it just, tiny bit of melting and that liquid water just froze everything solid. So we had to go back to the drawing board and develop a sequence that would get the water ice and take it in such a way that it would never be exposed to sunlight. And I finally went in there and we found water ice, you know, which we knew was there. But it was a very successful mission from that point of view. There was also some fun things. That's at the top of the meteorology mast. You see it blowing back and forth? We didn't have enough money for an actual velocity measurement. So our Danish crew got some wire and got a weight and hung it on top of this, coming out of this little brace at the top of the meteorology experiment. The magnitude of deflection gives you the velocity. The direction gives you the direction of the wind. And it was calibrated properly in the terrestrial environment. I thought that was pretty cool. It cost, I don't know how many Danish, what are Danish for kroners. So if you look here, those of you who are close up can see little crystals forming. That was snow. We actually saw water ice snow. We saw it with a laser looking up and you could see things coming back down. We saw snowstorms of water ice, even though the atmosphere is very thin, very dynamic planet. It has its own what's called hydrology today. That's completely different than anything on the Earth. Okay, let's do cars on Mars. And I promise to tell you how we drive them, but not everything. Because I still have the keys in my office. I was embedded with the engineers who did the planning as a surface property scientist when I was still employed by Washington University. Now I'm a backseat driver. So you know the people in the front, the driver and the passenger, do not like comments from the backseat. Particularly, I told you so's, but sometimes they need to hear it. So this has been fun because I'm not responsible for the sequences, but I can make comments. Some snide, some appropriate, but I know these folks very well because we're a good team. So here's a Cars on Mars kind of collage. Sojourner 1997 was an experiment associated with the Pathfinder lander. Spirit and Opportunity that I co-led in 2004. And Spirit lasted till 2009. Opportunity, as we said, till 2018. Those were follow the water, and they found evidence for the water. Opportunity landed on ancient lake beds. Spirit drove to something called the Columbia Hills with exploding evidence for exploding volcanoes. Curiosity, the one I'm involved with as a backseat driver right now, in 2012 to evaluate whether there were habitable zones on the planet. And Perseverance landed in 2021, is getting drill cores, which will be returned to Earth. I'm not on the science team, but our lab is the key lab through the planetary data system geosciences know to archive all the data, all the way through the cores returned to the Earth. So anyone who wants information has to come to Rudolph Hall electronically to get the data. Sojourner, I have to tell you a story. So the way people, NASA actually selects landing sites for all these guys is to have what are called group meetings from the community. The last one for selecting the Perseverance site I attended, it was in Glendale, California, in a big auditorium, and everybody was talking where they wanted to land. And that was in the morning. Then we broke for lunch. We'd start up at 1 o'clock. So I was going to be out on 1 o'clock to talk about whatever I was going to talk about. And we broke for lunch, went down the street, went to a deli, and there were four of us seated like this with a little platform looking out. Fox was making a movie because we could see all the movie vans parked. I know the young people know this, but have you seen the movie The Martian or read the book? How many of people have seen The Martian, the movie, more than once? There you go. We got our nerds. So I was seated there. I was going to be on at 1 o'clock. I was trying to hurry. Who walked by? Matt Damon. And I thought to myself, self, let me introduce myself to Matt Damon. Wouldn't it be cool with an audience of 300 nerds out, not you people, but in Glendale, if Matt Damon came on and helped me do the presentation? I chickened out. And by then he was gone. So it could have been a really cool story. Never as cool as the Neil Armstrong story, but still a good story. So you have to test these vehicles because they're not like orbiters, where there's a defined path. These are like teenagers. You tell them to do something and they may or may not do something, but they do report home at the end and say, I didn't do this, or I did do this. So usually when men pack, it's like an hour before you leave, right? Whereas the ladies spend days and days packing. I forgot a hat in the Mojave Desert in the summer in the Dumont Dunes. So Walmart, $11. It fell apart toward the end, but that's okay, it did its job. This shirt I almost wore tonight. Because don't men have clothes from the 20th century that you just don't want to give up? Same here. But I decided to wear the full Monty. So what's in front of us there, that's a little test vehicle for spirit and opportunity that we managed to get from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. That thing called Scarecrow is basically curiosity without a brain, but the right mass. So we're simulating driving and looking at how well can we drive on sand dunes. And there we are. And Nathan Stein is in the audience. And Christina Kreisch, another undergraduate, both Pathfinders, helped me here. If you want to drive on sand or snow, have big old wheels, not small wheels that are 9 inches, but ones that are a lot bigger, because the bigger the wheel, the more traction you have in the direction you want to go. It's that simple. It's a whole area called terra mechanics that I'm not going to bore you with, but yeah. I think I didn't know where my hat was. I got another hat and then found the hat. So now we're off in what's called the Tecupa lake deposits. And we wanted to test driving on friable bedrock. So here we are with Scarecrow. And here's what happened in the test. It's noisy. We didn't go anywhere. That's called 100% slip. You just spin in place. What's happening is this is basically a desert pavement over sand. You kick away the rocks and you're driving in sand, but it's worse than that because you have rocks that impede the progress. So that was a lesson, because what you're interested in is mobility. How steep a slope can you go as a function of material? So that was pretty neat. What we did was to do all that testing and redid the vehicles and the instruments until we were pretty sure they were going to work properly. And we wanted to avoid something like this. This is something that Steve Squires and I put together as a joke. This never happened on the surface of Mars. And this is the opportunity, or the Spirit Rover rock abrasion tool, which is the business end right there on the robotic arm, trying to abrade a rock. Deployment's okay. But if you get the torques wrong, this did not happen on Mars. But the message is clear. Pardon?
It did happen in the States.
No, it happened in animation. God, if that happened in the States, I wouldn't be on this stage. Okay, let's go on to Curiosity. I'm going to skip over Spirit and Opportunity because I've talked about that many times. Curiosity is the one that landed in 2012. Big old rover. And it's really focused on, was Mars once habitable? It is a battle cruiser, right? Those wheels are yay big in terms of diameter, this wide. And there are six of them. It's a six-wheel drive vehicle. They're damaged. And if the questions and answers, you ask me some questions, I'll tell you why. It was my job to understand why. All sorts of capabilities, including the ability to drill, get a powder, and put it back into the rover. And a laser that shines out and produces a big pit in the target, makes a plasma, and as that plasma cools down, you can actually get the composition. Lots of good instruments. So we landed in 2012, August 5th, right in this 96-mile-wide crater called Gale, and there's a 3-mile pile of sedimentary rock formed in water and wind, and the bottom has to be old, the top has to be young. So the thought was, as you drive up the hill, you go from the oldest rocks to the youngest rocks that are exposed. And that's exactly what we've been doing since 2012. We didn't have to worry about dust storms because this was nuclear powered, and it has plutonium-238 hanging off the rear end. And when that decays, it makes heat, which is used with an exchanger to charge up the batteries. It's so hot in the beginning, when the wind blew from the back of the rover to the front, the meteorology boom, we could increase the, sense the increase in temperature. This is the landing site using a sky crane, which seems magical to me. So you come in with an aero shield, with a hypersonic parachute, and toward the end, you've got the sky crane, which is a rocket system, and then you lower the rover on cables about 30 yards, and when it touches down, wheels first at about half a meter per second, or half a yard per second, which is, considering it's coming in at miles per second at the top of the atmosphere, is pretty good. It's all automatic, like 5 to 10 minutes. There's nothing you can do about it. So you're waiting to make sure it all happens. And then you get the first images back, and there's a big sigh of relief. But that's the landing site. And those retro rockets blew away the soil, the regolith. And incredibly, this is what we see. These are river gravels. In fact, we're kind of close to the rim. And tomorrow I'll talk about an alluvial fan, or a river that was active, bringing in a lot of sediment, coarse grain sediment, a jumble, and depositing it, kind of like you see in Death Valley. And there's no questioning that this was produced in a river system. And in fact, Becky Williams, was a graduate student with us, published the key paper in Science. When she was here, it was Becky Eby. Well, is this Mars? There are two ways to tell. Three. It says Chile. There are folks walking around, which we haven't done. And the sky is blue. But you can see it's the same stuff, the same set of conglomerates. That was a pretty good first thing to see, you know, the first color images coming out once we drove off the landing site. So here we are, we do a lot of selfies. So there's a huge robotic arm with a camera called Molly on it. And to do a selfie, you just basically swing around and take a lot of pictures and then paste them together. And where you have gaps, you kind of Photoshop it in, but don't tell anybody. So that's what it looked like back in, a couple years ago. We're now, as of September 5th, the day after landing is called a sol. It's 39 minutes longer than an Earth day, 3,584, and we've gone 17.8 miles, which is pretty good. And we have enough plutonium energy for another about 5 years worth of traversing. In fact, Abby Freeman is here, and she's another former PhD student. She's the deputy project scientist for this mission. And what we found were river sandstones and lake beds. And if you come to my boring talk tomorrow, we'll go through all the details to demonstrate how we came to this conclusion. This is what it looks like from the surface, looking toward Mount Sharp. Curiosity today, I don't know, it's somewhere in this melange of junk in here. But these areas are all full of river sediments and lake beds, chock full of clay. We think those intermediate sediments, kind of up here, are all kind of shallow water evaporites, like sulfates, and some stream beds. And then you go to the tippy top, and these places are probably bone dry. Now, I'm going to tell you about Mont Mercou because it has a special place in terms of Washington University participation. It's this little bump here, right over here, Mont Mercou. And we got to name things, and IAU didn't find out about it, because they don't care about small things, just the big things. They'll eventually come around and do whatever they're gonna do, but I'm retired, who cares? Stratigraphy and sedimentology. So this is a figure from my colleague, Chris Veto at the University of Tennessee. I'm not gonna go through this, but when you put this together in what's called Glen Torridon, here's the interpretation. So there's the crater rim, here. There's the middle, which is a central peak. And back during what's called Jura rocks, there was a lake here. And then these are the alluvial fans coming in, sandstones and gravels, mudstones here, central peak there. Knockfarrel Hill is a little bit younger rocks that was in the previous slide. And that lake's kind of drying up. So as we go uphill, we're going to younger and younger rocks. And we're actually seeing the drying out of the planet, the climatic changes, and that's what we're trying to interpret. Mont Mercou is special. You know, when you're about to retire, whoever is running scheduling classes doesn't know what to do with you. They don't want you in the main classes because you're kind of a, what's the thing called when you're not reelected? Lame duck. You're a lame duck professor. So I did anything I wanted to do. So I invented a class called What is Curiosity Doing This Week? And got the project scientist and Abby, the deputy project scientist, to agree that we could use some of the data. And our students, all like 14 of them, planned missions the same way that the folks, the professional team at the Jet Propulsion Lab was doing. And Ellie Moreland, who's in the audience, was the TA when she was an undergraduate. So we really wanted to go to this hill, and we got to name it. And we did it democratically in the classroom. And what do you guys want to call this one? Let's call it Mount Merku, I said. Yeah, let's do that. And then I noticed they all took out their phones, and they were texting. They were texting their parents. We just named something on the planet Mars. I said to them, don't tell the IAU. It's 18 feet tall. It's a cliff face. We drove right up to it. This is a pre-launch view of the laser-induced breakdown spectrometer doing compositions on this made-up cliff. It's eerie. It's the same height, roughly. It's the same freaking shape. So we convinced, through the course, we convinced the whole team to go right up against Mount Merku, which is what we did. And it turned out to be phenomenally important. There are more strata above there. We think those are ancient, very shallow lake beds that would evaporate, and then sand dunes in between, kind of drying out of Mars as you go higher up. That's what it looks like when you're just up there. Less oxidized, more oxidized, and you can see these striations. Are these mudstones formed in the lake? And then, you know, this image came down on the left. That's a cut and fill structure. This is in Nova Scotia. You can tell it's a blue sky. There are pine trees, grass. We could put a person in there if you want. It's the same thing. This is a riverbed that was running right through this area back in the day before this big mound was totally formed and then eroded down by wind. Really interesting. And you can see all these dikes that are cutting across. They're made out of gypsum, calcium sulfate. Same thing in your walls. And they form by groundwater. We've done a lot of drilling, found a lot of organics, a lot of clays, a lot of hematite. We'll talk more about that tomorrow. It's all looking good. We had an extended warm, wet environment with a lake for a long period of time. We had all the right stuff, but we don't know if they were biochemically produced in the way that are prebiotic, and then if life got started and evolved. Where the evidence is there, because we moved from follow the water to kind of examine the habitability. And the mineralogy is such that when you back calculate the water conditions, they weren't particularly toxic. They weren't really low acidic or high alkaline. So it's looking good. We're continuing to climb upstairs. And over the next 4 or 5 years, we'll be moving into more and more dry conditions. And in fact, we just passed a place that looks exactly like ancient sand dunes, now the rock record, with a little ephemeral lake on top of it, and then succeeding more and more of these. And as we go further upstairs, it should become drier and drier. Guys, we're actually inferring the paleoclimate of the Red Planet. This is 3.5 billion years ago. Let's go on to Perseverance. Another battle rover with a lot on the end, including a drill. And right now they're getting drill cores. Where are they? Another crater. This one is about 30 miles. It's called Jezero. There's an ancient river channel coming in, one going out. So we think this was a lake at one point and a delta, just like the Mississippi Delta, just like this. You know, there is, I don't know, where is New Orleans? Up there somewhere. So this is basically a bird delta. All the Mississippi River coming out, dropping into the sea, and you get these foreset, these cross beds, and then lake bed deposits a little bit further out, or what are called bottom sets. And it's prograding out or moving out into the sea. This is the delta that we have on Mars, which is being explored. This is about 6 miles from top to bottom. You can see the dry river coming in. coming into a lake, depositing itself, landed here, there, right there. And the next image is the edge of this delta. It's been eroded by wind because it's completely dry today. And those are little sand dunes at the bottom. And I'll show you, that's the edge of the delta. It's been exposed by wind. It's cross-bedded rocks. And cross-bedded means there was current and things were moving. It's probably sandstone. But we have, the team has yet to go up and make measurements here. So it's all coming up. It has a drill. And it has cores that are being collected. And a bunch of cores have already been collected. It's hard to tell, but if you look in there, there's a rock. And it's about the size of my pinky. And these are some of the cores that have been collected in various locations. They're all going to be contained. And then Perseverance will drive back in the future to a lander with an ascent rocket and put these cores in the nose cone to get them back to Earth. And that's going to happen in about 2023. A lot of different rocks. It also had Ingenuity that you may know about, a copter. Now, the atmosphere of Mars is 1/100th as dense as the Earth's. The gravity is 3/8 Earth's gravity. So you need spinning like anything, 2,300 rounds per minute, like flying at 100,000 feet in Earth's atmosphere. It has that mass, which is that number of pounds on Mars. And guys, we know that weight and masses are different, right? So you go from Earth to the moon, you weigh less. You go from Earth to Mars, you weigh less. Tell the reporters, because they didn't know that. They talked about this as 4.5 pounds, but that's the Earth weight. And in fact, it did work. There it is. It was brought there in the underbelly of the rover. It deployed as a technology experiment. And this is the first flight. And since then, it's done a number of flights, acting kind of as a recon for the Perseverance rover. And it's also at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. We're looking at bigger and copters and successful coppers that could have more payloads to look at vertical sections. So it might be something coming up in the future. So this is what Jezero looked like 3 billion years ago and the Delta, the reconstruction. It was warm and wet based on all the data we have from the landed missions that we're looking at the ancient rock records. So is this what Mars is going to look like coming up in the future? Probably not. Probably not. So let's finish this up. This is one of the pictures I love the most. This is an image taken by the Spirit rover, Mars sunset. That little dot is us. That's the Earth. We're studying Mars basically to better understand the Earth and us. Are we alone in the solar system? Are there other areas of the solar system, other habitable planets in the past where life got started and evolved? And here's the crazy thing. Mars has exchanged meteorites with the Earth. We know, because there are meteorites that you can pick up, particularly in Antarctica, because they're black, that smell just like Mars. But as you bake them in mass spectrometers, they have the right composition of the Mars atmosphere. It's possible. Maybe some of my security group here, Posse, has Martian, Jim Small, Martian, yes, definitely you, might have Mars ancestry. We're doing this basically to understand ourselves. Earth is our planet. We need to take care of it. We need to better understand it. And to me, one way to do that is called comparative planetology. So that's my ride for the past 50 years in terms of exploring Mars and doing some other things and working with students. I thank you very much. Security team, you're on call for stage rushes.
Ray, thank you very much for a wonderfully entertaining and informative talk, as usual. And I think all of you already know this. This is what has made Ray such a wonderful professor for his many years at Washington University, among the best. And I thank you, and I know everybody else does. Now, we have time for some questions. So, are there any questions either in the audience or from our guests on YouTube? Here's a question over here. Yes. Microphones, and here comes the microphone.
Hi, I'm Izzy. I actually took your class freshman year, and it's the reason I'm an earth science major.
There you go, girl.
I had different colored hair back then, so I may not be recognizable. But my question is, how do you keep...
You're Izzy.
Yes.
Oh, got it.
How do you keep technology safe on the rovers from the radiation in the Mars atmosphere and on the surface?
Oh, yeah. Good questions. How do you make sure when you send something to the planet, there are two things to think about, that you're not contaminating the planet with us, right? Because the worst thing to happen, you go there in a century and you find us. So there's something called planetary protection. I'll get to your question, which means that you have to really sterilize everything that's going to touch the surface, which we do. Now, how do we get ready? There are huge temperature variations. There's radiation. And we know those from previous measurements, for example, in the Viking landers in Phoenix. And you build the engineering to withstand those temperature changes, the characteristics of the surface, the radiation hazard. There's no magnetic field today. There used to be one. So cosmic rays reach the surface. And they're damaging. And you can actually see them in the images because they knock out some of the pixels called cosmic ray hits. And then the other thing is that there's no ozone, so ultraviolet radiation gets to the surface. So you have to design for all those. And that's why you go back to all this testing, right? You're testing to make sure it's going to work. You test it with environments that you expect to see on the planet. You bombard it with nuclei. You bombard it with ultraviolet radiation until you're sure you can do it. Mars is easy compared to, you know, what Bill McKinnon does on the outer planets. The radiation is incredible. You know, to Jupiter, for example, but it's pretty much under control. And again, we didn't lose opportunity from 2004 to 2018. She was still going. It was ancient. Like me, it has body parts that don't work well, but it was still going until it was just hit by the biggest dust storm ever.
Yes.
Question from the security group.
Oh, here comes the microphone. Use the mic.
All right. Are there any schemes? Are there any schemes under development for the removal of dust or frost from the solar panels?
Yeah, the question is, any schemes under development for removal of dust from the solar panels? The dust comes and goes, right? So for Spirit and Opportunity, dust was never a factor until the huge dust storm. Because what would happen, and you saw that in the last video, there are these little dust devils. We've had dust devils go across both Spirit and Opportunity. And you come in the next day, said, wait a minute, this is a replacement. This looks like ran out of the showroom because all the dust was taken off. There are people looking at electrostatic repulsion and some other things. The real issue is if and when humans go to Mars, and dust is not our friend. You know, just as it was on the moon with the Apollo astronauts. Plus, it has perchlorate in it, which is toxic. So that's something under study right now. But, you know, Curiosity, Perseverance are nuclear powered. And the lander that's going down, has the ascent rocket, won't be there that long. and it will probably go in a season when the dust storms aren't prevalent. So it's a problem, but and people are looking forward, you know, to how to do kind of taking care of it, if you will. But my key worry is what is a habitat and astronauts and the dust. So.
In the back.
We need to get questions in the middle because these guys are running from place to place.
Tell me about the presence of methane on Mars.
Yeah,
and the findings of methane. That's my first question. Part B is fossilized things.
What? Fossilized what?
Bacteria.
Part B is easy. Haven't seen any, but haven't had anything to look.
Okay.
Part A, methane. Okay, here's the thing. There's a hole in the side of Curiosity that's plugged. You open it up, suck in some gas, and there's a spectrometer that detects methane. The methane is CH4. It can come from several areas. It can come from waste dumps, probably not on Mars. It can come from swamps, probably not on Mars. It can come from bacteria or archaea beneath the surface, perhaps. It could come from geologic reactions with carbon dioxide and basaltic rocks. We see it occasionally, but not always, and it seems to come in pulses. It's also identified, this is just a few parts per billion level. These are very sensitive instruments. It's also seen from one of the European orbiters and not from another one. And then it's sometimes seen telescopically from the Earth. So I think Curiosity has the best measurements. So there are pulses coming out now and then. And it's not coming from the rover. And part B is we haven't had anything on Mars that is of sufficient spatial resolution to test for microorganisms, fossils.
Given the pulses.
Wait, this is part
methane.
C?
Yeah, this is part C, sorry. Okay. Given the pulses of methane that you're finding and the patterns of the data, what's the most likely source of the methane?
I think it's a geologic remnant of interactions beneath the surface. We know there's carbon dioxide beneath the surface because we have evidence for it in terms of carbonates. We know there's a lot of basalt. We know there's been water. So you can concoct chemical reactions that produce methane. You guys in the middle asleep? I have no questions at all.
Okay, it's a comment and a question. I can't be Matt Damon, but I was born in Glendale, California.
Oh, Mark, hi.
Huh?
Hi.
Hi. My question is, you take a movie like The Martians, which is a popular movie. How does a movie like that help forward the mission of understanding scientifically Mars?
Yeah.
Does it increase its importance?
Yeah. So the question is, the Martian, which is both a book and a movie, and very popular, you know, what does it do in terms of science and advancing science and interest in Mars exploration? I think it's done a lot, actually. When Andrew wrote that book, he knew it couldn't be all real. For example, Margaret, would you go on a rocket where the front of it was encased by a tarp? Probably not, but he had to have some exciting parts in it. But most of it, he spent a lot of time talking to engineers and scientists to get it right. And my impression is it really kind of increased the interest in Mars exploration.
Thanks for the incredible talk. Just out of curiosity, any interesting backstory to how these rovers are named?
How they what?
Rovers are named.
Oh, the rover names are interesting. So they're done by contests. And Spirit and Opportunity were named, I think, by middle school students. And Abby Curiosity, where'd Abby go? She's Abby Curiosity was another national contest.
Yeah, Clara Ma, I think.
Yeah.
A middle school student.
Middle school. And Perseverance?
Middle school student.
Middle school students. I have a problem with Perseverance because we lost Opportunity in Perseverance Valley. But that didn't go too well. So.
Abby, do we have any questions from the YouTube channel?
Yeah, we have a couple questions from the back here. One is thinking about the future of Mars exploration and ingenuity. And what do you think is the limit of future drones on Mars? And do you think they could ever replace rovers?
Oh, Abby, You're involved with JPL in planning a future drone mission, so you pick that one.
No comment.
Yeah. I think, you know, the drones have a place. There are locations on Mars that are cliff-like, up to like 3 miles high in Valles Marineris. And I think what Abby's thinking about, even though she has no comment, is if you have a drone of the appropriate size and you can afford it, it can go up and down and it can measure those strata, because that's another kind of geologic history of the planet. And there are other places that are just too rough, you know, to get rovers to drive through, but you could go from place to place. In fact, there's a mission that we're involved in called Dragonfly, which is going to Titan. It's one of the moons of Saturn in 2034. Titan rains methane and ethane. It has an atmosphere that's thicker than the Earth's atmosphere. It has a low gravity. It has lakes of methane and ethane and rivers. And Dragonfly is a copter that will fly from place to place. So it's like a rover mission, but it doesn't have wheels. So I think the whole idea of aerial mobility has a big future for planetary exploration, except for the moon. Why? There's no atmosphere, right?
Right here, Kun.
Do we think, there I am, right here.
Got it.
Do we think geologically—
Is that Bill?
Yes, it is. Okay. Now you're in for it. Do we think geologically, as we explore deeper and deeper in space, and now the web is doing all this analysis, that there is like a homogeneous component to the universe where we're going to keep finding the same kinds of elements, the methane, or do we believe that as we go deeper, it's going to be radically different elements? And
no, gases, it's the same
or
stuff.
Or is it just a whole, everything is more or less built of the same?
It's the same components. Stuff, Bill. Unless I'm wrong. I mean, for example, Mars minerals are just like Earth minerals, with the exception of one or two weird ones. So I don't think there's, Marty Israel, as we go further and further out, it's going to be the same set of elements, right? He shook his head, yes. He's an astrophysicist.
Okay, I have a question about how the study of geology on Mars has influenced the thinking of geology on Earth, and have they influenced each other or changed your understanding of geology on either planet?
Yeah, here, generally, you know, you have two objects that have geological histories, different sizes, different distances from the sun. One of the big issues, a huge issue, in fact, is the geology of Mars that I showed you demands liquid water. Early in geologic time, when the sun was less strong, so it's the sunlight that heats the surface and gets you up to the melting point of ice. And yet this happened when the sun was less strong and Mars was 1.5 times further as it is today from the sun than the Earth is. How do you do that? Right? So the climatologists, I'll talk about this tomorrow, are saying, geologists, are you sure you're right? Is there no other way to explain this? I said, oh, just go back into your office and figure the darn thing out. Because you must have had massive greenhouse effects when the volcanoes were active. They must have had clouds that had just the right optical properties to warm the surface, because you have a huge range to increase to get to 32 Fahrenheit to have a liquid water. So that kind of bouncing back and forth is happening. And it's the same physical models for climatology that you use on Mars, that you use on Earth, that you use on Venus. But now you have three, you know, natural laboratories to test them. And the geology that we're seeing on Mars is eerily like the Earth. So that experience that we have from field geology that many of us have done, and there are people on the Curiosity and Perseverance team that have done that for a living, that are now involved in the Mars mission saying, well, this could be Arizona, you know, in terms of the rock record. So that bouncing back and forth is happening the whole time. And it's called comparative planetology. But you know, the main point is the geologists say, climatologists, you need to make this warm and wet 3.5 billion years ago. I know the sun was not as strong. I know Mars is further away, but do it. And there are at least three models that get us there that I'll show you that were concocted, especially by tweaking Earth models and taking them to Mars.
Ray?
I'm only asking this because
this is another bill.
Yeah, I'm only asking you because you and I both just retired and we're not getting any younger. You mentioned
are we talking about Medicare? Earth.
Is it going to happen before we keel over? That's kind of my question.
Oh, yeah, there was a National Academy study that I was involved in that was led actually by an engineering graduate. And we calculated that at best, there are so many technical problems and medical problems, it's 30 years into the future. For example, the transit time is 6 months from where we are to get to Mars, and then you land, and you're on the surface for months and months and months with no radiation protection, another 6 months to get back. That's more than astronauts can take with cosmic rays because there's really no way to shield them today. And that disrupts the DNA and leads to better chance to get cancer, et cetera. Now, it turns out there's a Harvard study that if you eat a lot of broccoli, it will alleviate that. So you can imagine there's the capsule with the astronauts. There's the other capsule with the broccoli garden. Who knows? There's a lot of problems to solve. We don't know, you know, how, we can't take all the water, we can't take all the fuel onto the surface. So we have to do a lot of what's called in situ resource utilization. And part of that is on the Perseverance rover where they're taking carbon dioxide and making oxygen. And oxygen is the oxidizer. There's carbon dioxide, there's water ice, you can make methane. Now you have the fuel to come home. And if you can tap the water, you know, then you can take a shower. So I think it's way off in the distance. It's different in timing than NASA says. And NASA didn't appreciate our report, but what can you do? Thanks, Bill.
Quinn, down front. And, oh, Abby, go ahead. Why don't you go first, Abby, and then we have a question down in the front.
Okay, I have a quick one and then a longer one. The quick one is from Scott Maxwell, who wants to know what your favorite rover is and reminds you that there is only one correct answer.
Scott Maxwell was one of the rover engineers I worked with Spirit and Opportunity, but he since went to the dark side and works for Google. Scott, I like Spirit and Opportunity because you worked on them.
Excellent answer. There's another question about the Viking life detection experiment and whether there's any talk about doing it again, but improving it based on what we learned from the failures of the first try.
Well, here's the thing. The worst place to look for organics and life is in the Martian regolith. Why? There's no magnetic field. Cosmic rays come right down to the surface. Those are protons through heavy nuclei, and they actually disrupt organics quickly. In addition, ultraviolet radiation gets right to the surface because there's no ozone. So the worst place to look for ancient life or extant life is the surface. So you look at what's left in the rock record, or you drill down where those effects are not evident. That has to be meters beneath the surface. So I don't think, you know, Viking was built during the era when people were still drawing canals on Mars maps and they don't exist. So, you know, it's live and learn. And it was a great set of experiments, but we didn't know much at that time.
Yes, sir. Go.
Ray, here. The entire presentation.
Where are you?
I'm over here. Vaughn Brokaw.
I'm sorry.
Your entire career and this presentation has displayed a terrific progress in scientific discovery. And you have done it in an open society in which information is shared freely. You've described Washington University as being a center for all your data.
Yeah.
To what extent, and so everybody in the world has access to what you have done, to what extent have the Chinese and the Russians and the Japanese and other countries that are into this sort of thing also shared information freely, and to what extent have you learned from them at all?
It's an excellent question. We make data available to anyone on the Earth through the World Wide Web, for the landed data, for the orbital missions, for laboratory experiments in our archive. We work very closely with the European Space Agency, 13 nations in Western Europe, who have equivalent, you know, access capabilities and free access. Japanese tend to hold on to their data for a long time, but eventually the data got released. The Indian Space Agency, which has had an orbiter around Mars, makes the data available. Until early 2022, we were working with the Russians. And the problem is they didn't have much data, because most of their missions have gone not to Mars, but in the ocean, because it never got out of Earth orbit. The Chinese we're not allowed to work with, and that's by act of Congress, if we're trying to use any federal money. And they tend to keep their data very close and release to certain parties, and eventually, when it's to their advantage, release bits and drabs. So it varies, but the Western democracies, it tends to be all open. It's fascinating, you know, talking to students about this, because it's not only science, but it's also societal and political in terms of getting the data and making the data available, and cooperating in terms of missions. For example, there's a Russian instrument on Curiosity called DAN, the neutron spectrometer, and we still work with them, you know, even though it's becoming more and more difficult.
Okay, we have a question on the right-hand side, right down here.
Yeah, Heather. Thank you. And actually, my question follows up on that nicely. It's about politics. So,
she's a lawyer,
recovering politician. So, as we learn more,
and former, what were you?
An alderwoman, yeah. City council person. You know, yeah. What, so, as we
look, politician and lawyer.
I have legitimate questions too. So, as we learn more,
former student. Come on, get it out, Heather. Okay.
As we learn more about Mars, it seems like the interest in exploration is going to grow, and those interests will be varied. And yeah, you touched on some of the other countries that are active there. So besides NASA and the US, who else is on Mars? And how do you see the politics playing out as this interest grows?
Yeah, it's currently the United Arab Emirates has an orbiter around Mars. The Chinese Space Agency has an orbiter and a lander, a rover on Mars. We have multiple orbiters, two rovers, NASA. The European Space Agency was going to launch their ExoMars rover. It had Russian participation and Russian launch system, but that's no longer existent. So they're waiting a couple, 3 years. The Indian Space Agency has been exploring Mars. So it truly is international, and it's all focused around habitability and life and accessibility and eventually humans. So it is an opportunity for cooperative activities in space. But given the current political situation around the Earth, it's hard to see that happening in the near future, unfortunately.
Folks, let's do one more question in the room and one more question in YouTube. Abby, have you got any more?
Yeah, I'll ask a question from Lindsay Weber. What was your favorite course to teach and why?
The course you took, Lindsay. Land dynamics in the freshman year. I think you were either EULID or Pathfinder. And I think that got you on the road to becoming a hydrologist for a while, if I remember correctly. That's truly the case. You know, teaching the EULID and the Pathfinders. Land dynamics, we spent the semester, you know, talking about Mono Lake in California. And also talking about greenhouse warming. Sometimes we did the Missouri River, sometimes we did the Ozark forests. And then in the spring, I brought them all out to the Mojave Desert for a week, which was fascinating because most of them had never been to the desert before, the deep desert. The only thing that scared me is, did they remember not to go near rattlesnakes? And then in the sophomore year over winter, we went to the Big Island of Hawaii. Not for R&R, but rather we studied the geology, the political situation, the agriculture, the cultural history of the island. So those were my favorite courses to teach. But graduate students, I also love teaching remote sensing.
Okay, and in the back, Sarah.
Hello, Ray. I didn't know this was going to be the last question, but my question is asking you to
Harvey, is that you?
To be, I don't know who Harvey is.
Harvey is an individual, an employee of the university. In presentations, we're not allowed to sit together because we come too rowdy and get thrown out of the audience. Harvey, at his wedding, as the bride was marching up.
Oh my goodness.
There burst out in beautiful song.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, Harvey, what's your question?
So, thank you, Ray. I do, and thank you so much, Eloise, for gracing us by being there at our wedding with us. We thank you for that. Again, this is going to be an envisioning question, and we've talked about some of the challenges of exploration of Mars. But from where you sit, and from the experience that you have, and from the, you know, projects you've worked on, the networks you've developed and are been exposed to, do you think there's a possibility where the ability to use advanced robots to can build underground shelters and facilities, and the generation of localized, appropriately localized magnetic fields, for example, can cause there to be the exploration of Mars, or for that matter, many other, any other planets in our solar system in the next 50 odd years or so? Is that technology being discussed, talked about, envisioned? Because we're doing some things now that people thought could never happen. What do you think might happen for the future? That's my question.
Our first answer is yes. But Harvey is saying the technology is evolving rapidly. In fact, by the time we put humans on the surface of Mars, if we do, robotic systems will be so freaking smart, they can do almost as much as the humans can do in terms of exploration. So it will actually be a joint activity. It's hard to envision, but the field of computers and robotics is advancing so quickly. And if we're not doing this for 30 years or so, you know, really need to kind of have a new paradigm for, you know, how to explore planets. And I think the answer to your sub question is also yes, but I forget what it is.
But again, it has to do with the protection of the human beings.
Oh, yeah.
In other words, localized fields that can protect from the electromagnetic radiation.
I got you, Harvey.
Et cetera. Okay.
Yeah. So the broad question is, are we going to put humans on the planet? I think the answer is yes, because we're explorers. And I think we'll have the technology for protection and the technology for getting there and living there. I do not believe I'd ever want to live there, though. I like the Earth, and we need to take care of it, right? The whole idea of terraforming is just an absolutely bogus concept. Mars is what it is. Sorry. Mars is what it is. It is. Because of the geology, and you're not going to change that. So Earth is a place that we have to protect, and we explore to better understand the whole amalgam of objects in the solar system and us.
Harvey, that was a great question, and that's a great place for us to end on. And besides, I dare any of you to ask another question, because Ray will have something on you. Ray, it's been really wonderful to have you as the inaugural distinguished lecturer for the Earth and Planetary Sciences, and it's so fitting, and we've been so fortunate to have you at Washington University for these near 50 years, and we're really going to miss you in the classroom, but we just want to thank you for a wonderful, wonderful lecture this evening.
Thanks for coming, folks. Remember, tomorrow at 1:30, open house, to see what's happening in Rudolph Hall, and a boring talk here at 4:00.
Animal for this?
It's called the bird.